Hey everyone, Holden here with Gold Plating Services. Today we're going to be talking about the electroplating basics. This is a great video for beginners, but also those who are more experienced. Over time, it can be easy to forget or even overlook some certain routines or even tips that help ensure quality plating and the longevity of your solutions and equipment. We will discuss some of the best practices that we recommend implementing before, during, and after your plating process. Before. There are several things we recommend doing before you actually begin plating. It is best to be certain about the metal type of your project. You should know exactly what metal it is, if it has a clear coat, and if it has been heat treated. Knowing these details will give you more clarity about your plating process. However, sometimes it's not possible to know these things ahead of time, and if that's the case, then experimentation will be necessary. Our guide to help identify metal types, which is located under the tech support tab on our website, may be useful. If you don't have a clear understanding of what your items are made of, then it's important to have an extra piece that can be used to practice on. Before you begin a plating project, clean up your workspace. Having your work area clean, straightened, and organized will help with minimizing contamination and spills, keeping your pieces clean, and will help prevent misplacement of pieces. Always take safety into consideration. Check the safety data sheets of the solutions you'll be using and implement measures such as ventilation of your work area, gloves and eye protection, aprons, and anything you determine is necessary. Please be familiar with the precautionary statement that is found on each of our product labels. This information will tell you what to do if chemical exposure occurs. In case of emergency, seek medical attention and contact PERS, Professional Emergency Resource Services. Their contact information is listed on all the labels of our solutions. It is important to have plenty of distilled water on hand before you begin a project. Distilled water is necessary for rinsing items thoroughly between steps and is needed to top off solutions to replace evaporation loss. The reason it is crucial that water is distilled is that it does not contain any minerals that could affect the properties of your solutions and the finish of your plated items. Fill up clean rinse beakers with distilled water for your bath plating setup. We suggest using at least 2 rinse beakers between each step and 3 rinse beakers after the electroclean. It may also be helpful to have a spray bottle of distilled water on hand for parts that are shaped in a way that makes them difficult to fully rinse. For brush plating setups, a spray bottle of distilled water with a basin to catch the water may be sufficient for rinsing, but some people prefer to use rinse beakers as well. Some degree of evaporation of the solution will occur while plating. Bring the solution back to volume by adding distilled water. We do not recommend topping off evaporation loss with fresh solution because it can lead to overconcentration of the solution. Ensure that you have the proper anodes or bits for your project. Different solutions require different anodes. If you are unsure, double-check the plating procedure chart on our website that applies to your setup, found under the tech support tab. It is also important to occasionally check the condition of your anodes to see if there are any that are wearing down and need to be replaced. If your anodes or bits are starting to look older but still function well, it might be a good time to order more to have on hand for when they need to be replaced. Check your common leads. Sometimes there is corrosion around the alligator clips and you can remove them to clean them. We sell replacement alligator clips and replacement leads if they've become too damaged. If you are brush plating and you have corrosion buildup on your bits and handles, you will want to take them apart and use a wire brush or a sandpaper to scrub it off. Buildup corrosion can impede electrical flow. If you are bath plating, check your bus bars and sand them down if they have any buildup on them. Also, determine how you will rack your items. Large items might need to be racked in multiple areas to ensure enough electrical connection throughout the piece. Inspect used sleeves to ensure that they are not worn out or exposing the metal bit through the sleeve. If they are, replace them before beginning. Our brush plating sleeves can last for quite a while, but they will eventually wear out. Sometimes solutions will cause sleeves to break down quicker, such as our activators and our chrome stripper solution. Surfaces that are textured or rough can also cause more wear to the sleeves. Once the sleeve becomes thin enough and the bit is exposed, you run into the risk of scratching the surface that you were plating onto, and it will cause the machine to short out when the bare metal anode touches the item you are plating. Thoroughly soaking new, unused sleeves is critical. You can leave sleeves soaking in distilled water for an hour or so, or even overnight just to be certain. To speed up the process, you can manually massage the material in distilled water to help it absorb faster. Check out this short video for a visual of the process. After new sleeves have become saturated, even after they dry out between uses, they won't have a problem absorbing the solutions again. If you are bath plating, visually check your beakers or tanks before beginning a plating project to see if your solutions, or particularly plating solutions, have residue that has accumulated in them. All of our solutions can be poured through a coffee filter to remove particles, although some need to be heated first to thoroughly incorporate all the components. This is most critical to remove residue from plating solutions. Keep an eye out for solutions that you are low on or that are older and may need to be replaced soon, and then order backup solutions so you don't run out in the middle of a project. If you have a long-term bath that you are maintaining, or if you're doing very large quantities of plating, it is helpful to get in the habit of regularly testing the pH of your plating solutions. You can do this before and after plating. Our solutions are manufactured and shipped at the optimal pH, but regularly plating and many other factors change the pH over time. Refer to the TDS for each plating solution to find the appropriate pH range. If you are not regularly testing your pH, note that if your solutions have been working well and then you all of a sudden have issues plating, one of the things to test for in your troubleshooting process is your pH. Check out our video adjusting the pH of the Bright Gold Bath for more details on this topic. We strongly recommend beginning each project by plating sample pieces that are the same material as the items in your project. Practice on these items until the end result is what you are looking for. Prepare the surface of your items that you are going to plate. Methanol can be helpful for removing pencil and pen marks, while toluene works well for removing sticky substances that are left behind from labels. Thoroughly wash your parts with dish soap. Use an ultrasonic cleaner when necessary. Polish and prepare the surface so that the finish looks exactly the way you want it to look when you're done plating. Keep in mind that more sensitive metals such as brass, copper, and non-stainless steels are more prone to oxidization and can begin oxidizing if they sit in a solution such as the ultrasonic cleaner or electrocleaner for a long period of time. When working with these sensitive metals, we do not advise doing all your prep work up front and leaving these pieces raw and exposed to the air and moisture. Instead, prep less items at a time and quickly move on through the plating process. Another thing to consider during your surface prep step is if your items have been heat treated. If they have, then the normal process for that metal type may not work because the items can become unaffected by our surface activators. The heat treated surface might need to be removed. Removal usually is done by sanding, scrubbing, or a chemical process. With some metals, using our Trival Acid Gold Strike solution is sufficient to remove the heat treated surface as well as activate the underlying metal, but some metals may require more effort. During. Now that you're ready to start plating, let's talk about what is important to pay attention to throughout your plating process. Each of our solutions has a voltage range for brush and bath plating. We recommend always starting with the lower end of the range and working up. This way you will avoid issues such as overactivation or burning that can occur when voltages are too high. With experience, you will be able to find the highest voltage possible for your project that will give you the best results without causing issues. If you are brush plating, make sure your common lead is connected to your part via the alligator clip close enough to an area that you are plating. You may need to adjust placement to improve the electrical connection. If you are bath plating, make sure there is enough contact between your rack and your items for consistent electrical flow. Make sure to rinse well, particularly after using electrocleaner, which can sometimes take extra effort to rinse off completely, and when plating items that have a lot of places where solution can accumulate. When the rinse water begins to look dingy, replace it. Dragging dirty rinse water into your baths is one of the ways that they can become contaminated. Thoroughly rinsing will prevent cross-contamination of solutions and will prevent plating issues that can show up as water lines and streaks. It is not uncommon when bath plating several small items on a rack for an item to occasionally fall off into the tank. This is another reason why a visual inspection between steps is important. If you have noticed an item that is missing from your rack, make sure it has not fallen off into one of the tanks. Items that get lost or left in the bottom of a tank usually cause contamination of the solution. People often feel that they need to apply pressure when brush plating for the process to work, but pressing onto the surface of your item with the bit and sleeve not only wears the sleeve down, but it pushes the solution away from the area that you are trying to plate. This feels counterintuitive if you are accustomed to painting. As the amount of paint on your brush or roller gets low, you press harder to get more paint out of it. This does not work with electroplating. Keep your pressure very light. You're not rubbing the solution onto your surface. You are simply spreading it around and controlling where it goes. And the electrical current is making the adhesion happen. Also, it's always beneficial to keep replacement sleeves on hand in case you forgot to inspect well beforehand or if a sleeve is more worn out than you thought. It is necessary to visually inspect your items between each step of the plating process. Make sure your pieces are wetting out or hydrophilic, not just after using the electrocleaner, but after activation and pre-plates as well. This is often the most misunderstood step, so please refer to our video about wetting out. Make sure your items are not drying out between steps. If an item does dry out, you'll need to start over with step one. When bath plating with a metal such as gold, silver, or nickel, periodically remove your pieces from the plating solution so you can inspect them and make sure that they are plating properly. This way you can avoid the frustration of discovering an issue in the plate after an item has already been plating for several minutes. When gold plating by bath or brush, keep an eye out for burning. This happens if the voltage is either too high or if the sleeve is not continually moving over the surface while brush plating. It is easy to polish off, but the process can be time consuming. Hopefully an issue like this can be avoided beforehand by plating with sample pieces and determining what voltage will be best for your project. Do not move on if there are issues. We cannot stress this enough. If you have an item that is not wetting out or that is showing water stains or lines or any other issue, do not move on. Moving on will make the problem harder or more time consuming to correct. If you notice a problem, stop and troubleshoot it until you resolve it. If you're having a difficult time figuring out an issue, try plating onto a separate piece. This will help you determine whether or not the issue is being caused by your process, an old contaminated solution, or if the problem is the surface that you are plating onto. After. When you are finished plating, there are several things that you can do to wrap up your plating job to maintain your solutions and equipment. Do a final inspection of your plated items. Make sure there are no flaws and do a tape test to check for proper adhesion. To remove the surface of water spots, dip your items in distilled water, then methanol, and dry with a heat gun. Don't package up any items until you are sure they are fully dry. Make sure to turn off machines, power supplies, heaters, and agitators. Put the lids on solutions, and wipe up any drips and spills with water-dampened paper towels. Make sure to check the sides of the beakers and the inside of machine consoles of the brush plating machines. You can leave sleeves and bits attached to the handles and lay them out to dry on a surface that won't be damaged by the chemicals and that will not adhere to them as they dry, such as a plastic tray. If you do remove the bits and sleeves from the handles, you run the risk of mixing them up and then later contaminating the solutions. Rinse water and old solutions cannot be poured down the drain. There are area-specific regulations for the disposal of these chemicals. Please contact your local waste management for more details. After disposing of rinse water, make sure to scrub the rinse beakers with dish soap, rinse well, and allow them to dry between uses. If you are maintaining long-term baths, we recommend testing the pH of your solutions before you begin plating. But it is also wise to test them again after you finish plating, especially if it was a particularly long plating job. If you are putting equipment away to be stored for a long period of time, make sure the solutions are all tightly sealed in airtight containers. Ideally, keep them in a cool environment away from temperature extremes. It may be best to remove and discard sleeves used in brush plating setups. After sitting for a long period of time, these sleeves could disintegrate and stick to the bits. This can make your setup process more difficult the next time you use your machine. Store your equipment in a cardboard box. Electrical components could be affected if the machine is not able to fully dry out, so it is best if the equipment is not stored in an airtight environment. We hope this video has given you some helpful tips and reminders. We do our best to make the electroplating process as simple as possible so you can avoid running into issues. We want you to succeed. Electroplating is a craft, and each plating project contains multiple variables. There is a learning curve when you first start out and when you start expanding into new areas. Remember to take your time, plate on sample pieces, develop new troubleshooting techniques, and contact us when you need more support. Thank you guys so much for watching, and we hope you enjoyed the video. And if you want to see more, please leave a comment in below what you want to see next, and we'll see you in the next video.